Today we will talk about deforestation detection and how we are using artificial intelligence to try to improve this process. Actually, because now it's well known that we are living some dangerous climate change, and it's very important to have on a worldwide an inventory of where we have forests, what changes are happening in these forests, what kind of biodiversity we are losing, or how these forests are behaving, how we are performing changes on that, and how is that affecting the world climate, the world environment. So this is very important to not only to help on the decision making, on improving the processes on combating illegal deforestation, but it's also very important for better understanding what's happening with the world, because this data can provide several useful information on how this process is happening, where we are losing vegetation, where we are losing biodiversity, and how these ecosystems are being affected.
Okay, well, I think the next step now is, why do we use machine learning to do that?
We use that because, especially for performing that in a large scale, like if we talk only about the Brazilian Amazon, that's where I have my main focus, for obvious reasons, because it is the biggest rainforest in the world, the biggest tropical forest. And Amazon has, considering all the countries, has almost, the Amazon Basin has almost 7 million square kilometers, and where are about 5 million square kilometers are covered by forests. Mm-hmm. And performing all these analyses by hand is quite time consuming, it's expensive, and then especially for providing quick responses, it's good if we can automate these processes, because all this workforce that have been applied to construct these maps, they can use their valuable expertises for designing actions, for understanding the environment and things like that. So this is why we are trying to use machine learning to automate these processes.
Okay, and can you tell us a little bit, how does it work?
Basically, I have an example here of, in terms of machine learning, here we will basically get all this data, download a lot of image. When we talk about, for example, the last experiments I have performed with the Pará state, it generated, for training a neural network, 300 gigabytes of data. So basically, we download all that images, we get the labels from, usually now, to, let's say, teach the algorithms, teach the neural networks how to detect that. We get the maps from INPI. And here it's a very small example. It's composed by four Landsat tiles. And here we get all those data, we transform that in images, get the cloud masks, because some areas we will not be able to detect because of the clouds. So we can then classify several images to compose the final map. And here we get this image. We use it 4 years for training the network. We slice that image in several small tiles, because training that neural network is quite expensive computationally. It's quite hard. So we divide that in several small tiles. Then we can send to the network several small tiles at once, instead of sending an entire image or an entire data set of 28 gigabytes of data at once. And after that, we bring that to our neural network. The neural network will learn how to identify from these images here, how to identify what patterns are deforestation, what patterns are not deforestation. And then we have to slice again that image. In this case, we sliced that in smaller patches, as you will see here in the screen. Just because of operational thing, it's better to reconstruct the image later, and we don't have border effects on that. And then this network will compute several probabilities for each pixel of the probability of that pixel to belong to each class. And this is what you are seeing here, where we have in green the probabilities of being deforestation, in red probability of being not deforestation, and in blue the probability of being clouds. Okay. And then we have here the output map. You will see also in the screen and slide with both maps, the ground truth and the prediction of each side. And with that approach, we are already achieving a very good accuracy in the order of 95%.
What does that mean? That means that 5% of the time it is not correct.
Yeah, 5% of the time it's not correct.
Is that too much?
Actually, it's a very high accuracy. It's very good. But the problem is when it comes to deforestation detection, we cannot make this operational yet, because the most important thing of the deforestation detection part is not the overall accuracy, the final overall accuracy, but it's the amount of false positives you have. Because, for example, the data from WIMPY, that's the biggest reference in the world nowadays in terms of deforestation detection, they achieve less than 1% of false positives. What does it mean? More than 99% of the cases, they are correct when they say that area was deforested. Mm-hmm. And in our case, despite the overall accuracy is in most of the automated maps, and not only ours, but most of the automated maps that have been developed nowadays, the rate of false positives, apart from having very high overall accuracy, the rates of false positives are usually around between 5 and 8%. In the highest accurate methods. So this, for bringing these methods operational, it would bring a high cost in terms of fixing the methods, mm-hmm. And fixing the maps. And also, if you produce the maps directly with that, it would bring problems, because we could say that one area was deforested when it was not. And this is a serious problem when it comes to decision-making process. Mm-hmm. So I think this is the biggest challenge we need to tackle nowadays to bring this method operational, and also making them scalable for huge areas, because for processing an entire continent like South America, like Europe or Africa, we would have several terabytes of data to be processed. And optimize these methods for being able to process all this data in a feasible time is still a challenge. So I think this is the biggest challenge we are facing now to bring this operational.
Okay, and are we ever going to reach 100%?
100%, I think it's quite hard, mm-hmm. because even on visual analysis, when it talks to satellite images, 100% is quite hard, and even for human beings. Mm-hmm. And if a human being cannot identify that, probably the neural network will have difficulties to identify. It doesn't mean that the network will not identify, it just will be difficult. So,
and how far are we to reach a point where you can apply these algorithms and come up with a result that you can use without any issues to support decision making?
I think in the next few years we can hit very good results in terms of that. I cannot say that, okay, in 1 or 2 years we will be able to make it fully automated, but we can make it at least semi-automated, reducing a lot the human effort to that process, I think. We have several very interesting projects being developed in that sense, not only here at ITC, but also in several other institutions in the world. It's a problem that have been very studied by the scientific community nowadays.